my name is Harsh Jagadeesan. I work for SAP AG, and I work on illuminating business operations for our customers. So what I'm going to show you today is SAP Operational Process Intelligence, a new breed of a new product that's based natively on our in-memory platform, HANA, for real-time operational intelligence and for process management. I'm going to start. I want to tell you about a story. So you understand the pain points and you understand why we built what we built. So I'm going to take you into a logistics hub. So if you're ordering anything on Amazon and you have an express delivery, you have an Amazon Prime account, the shipment is shipped to you, it goes via multiple hubs and gateways, and we are going to get into one of these hubs. So we're talking about airline express carrier, and I want you to meet Gerd Richter. Gerd is the hub operations manager. He's been working with the logistics hub for more than 20 years now. And his job is extremely demanding. His day starts, his operational day starts at 7 in the evening and goes on till 4 in the morning. So by 7, there are close to 60 flights that are coming into this hub. And these flights are taking off by 4. So they're bringing in shipments. The shipments get sorted and repacked if needed. They put onto the outbound planes on the planes take off. There are close to 300,000 shipments. And during a season like Christmas or New Year, they have 600,000 shipments that go across the hub. And this happens 365 days a year. And his biggest problem is he wishes he can see problems before they hit him, right? There are always problems at such kind of volume. He has limited visibility into his current day's operations. That's his first challenge. He gets an Excel sheet, he gets a report saying what happened yesterday, that 470 shipments missed their connections, but he does not know now, so he could really influence these outcomes. So he doesn't know now to influence the outcomes. That's his biggest pain point. He has to ensure 97% on-time performance, which means every shipment that comes in has to go out. It cannot miss its connection. So think about it. Even it's the same for airline operations. If you're a big airline, you want all your passengers to make their connections. Otherwise, you get into problems, right? Especially if they are honorary circle members or something like that. And he has to sense these problems and dynamically allocate workforce to handle problems, because the hub still works in a very, there is a lot of old-fashioned manual work, loading, unloading, moving things around, and he has to be able to dynamically allocate his workforce and have a very good view of his resources. These are his problems, and he doesn't understand IT so much. He's an operations manager, and in the hub, there are close to 135 systems that are there, right, in the entire landscape. And this process of moving things from inbound planes to outbound planes into the right outbound planes on time, which is their core process, is performed in 16 systems. There are legacy systems, there are ramp management systems, there are mobile systems, so on and so forth. So there are several systems in the entire landscape. And each of these systems, if he has to figure out what's going wrong, he has to actually go and log in into several systems to figure out what's happening. Just to show you some pictures, this is how it looks in the hub. The planes are coming in 7, 8 o'clock in the evening. They're coming in. They're automatically guided to the right docks. The high loaders unload the unit loading devices, which contain the shipments. There are tucks and trolleys which move the unit loading devices into the warehouse. These are tucks and trolleys that move our luggages when a plane lands in a, when a passenger plane lands. These big pallets are broken down into small shipments. They're moved into the conveyor belt. There are shipments which cannot be put on the conveyor belt because they're non-conveyable, they're heavy. These shipments are scanned, sorted in a 6.5 kilometer conveyor belt. The shipments are repaired if they're damaged. There is customs check of shipments that happen if need be. Once they're sorted, the onward ULD is built up, it's pushed into the plane, and the plane takes off. So this is what happens in the hub. I just wanted to show you a picture. And what you see here is actually a process, right? So the operations of the hub is actually a process. So initially, the customer did not see it that way, but they were always referring it to it as a sequence of activities. And when we brought in the process notion, it became very clear to them that they look at their operations as a process, right? And what we actually give Gerd, who's been working with Excel sheets and things from the past, is something like this. This is an operational workforce. It can really give him the end-to-end view. So how many shipments, and in terms of phases, okay? So we have a higher order notion called as phases, which represents the value stream of this process. So these are the high level steps, and Gerd does not need to know or does not, he doesn't care which systems all these things are happening, all the activities are happening. He sees a value stream, and that's the notion of phases. Every phase has one or more milestones, the start of the phase, the end of the phase. There could be intermediate milestones as well. But that notion of phase and milestone depicts the value chain. So this is how he sees it on top. So let me just zoom in a bit. And I mean, when I was there and when we were doing a design thinking session there, you see that Gerd is working in different screen resolutions. He's working on a, he's actually having a big monitor in front of him. There are monitors all across the hub where they see all these key activities that are going in, and currently they have mechanical Turks, people entering Excel sheets and putting it up on those monitors, right? So you have a workspace which can fit into different resolutions. It can work on a big monitor, or it could also work on a small iPad that he's working with. And this value stream that he sees, he can really drill down into this value stream and look at, hey, what's the problem here? So he finds that there are problems in the warehouse. And the first thing he wants to always look at, which destinations are getting impacted and what are the departing flights that are getting impacted because of this problem. So he sees that, oh, not again, Cincinnati and Hong Kong, which is my other major hub on the east and west of the globe, there are problems. And these flights, the IEV-290 and the IEV-151 may not be able to take off, right? Or take off on time. And he also wants to find out which material category is causing the biggest problem. And this is always the non-conveyables, the oversized shipments that are causing the maximum problem. So he can really drill down here. And in the same context, so earlier he was actually writing emails to several people to deal with this. In the same context here, he could simply create a task saying, send more trucks for IEV-290-151, Hong Kong and Cincinnati. And he can say there are non-conveyables stuck in the warehouse. And he can simply loop in his ramp manager, Thomas, with an at mention. And he's just creating a collaborative task in order to solve this problem. And instead of losing the context in email, he's got the task right here, So he could really open the task. So there is a task that's created for this context. He could open this task. He could look at who are the participants. He could look at he could really collaborate on this task. He could see what is the history, and who are the participants, what are they doing, and so on and so forth. So he could really communicate on this task, and he could also complete this task, right? So hopefully Thomas or Claudia or one of his people are completing the task, and he could simply confirm that, okay, this task was done. So this is how, in the context of where the problem is, we could bring in a notion of tasks and also collaborative tasks to solve these problems right there in the context. And he could also go down into individual instances. So he could also see a traffic light. These are yellow shipments that are there. And he could really look at certain yellow shipments, which are shipments that have not gone beyond the threshold, but which have gone beyond the threshold. And he could really take action because before something goes wrong, really. So he can go into an individual instance if he so wants, and he could look at where is this instance today? At this point of time, where is this instance? How long has it been since it started? When did it arrive? And we also do a cycle time forecasting by using predictive analytics on certain proprietary algorithms to forecast the cycle time of when the shipment would actually go out. And he also sees the high-level faces right here. He sees a history of what's happened here. He could also take actions if need be. So it's all integrated in one place for him. And by the way, this is a live workspace, so which means there is data at rest coming in. There is data at motion from scanning events that happen everywhere, all into this dashboard. So we're mixing data at rest, data in motion, and getting all this big data. So there are close to, overnight, there are close to 18 million events that happen in the hub. So we're taking all of this big data and contextualizing into a process. And that's what we do here. There are also process metrics, real-time process metrics. These are not KPIs, which are calculated by analysts or calculated by other tools overnight. But these are real-time process metrics. Okay, that's my colleague. I'll just tell him I'm on stage. I'm sorry. So there are KPIs like load times, which are very, very important for him. The time to load a plane should be 30 minutes. And if it's going beyond on an average, then it's a problem. So he may have to assign loading groups. So he could go into such KPIs and also other KPIs like average time spent in customs. These are all process-related KPIs. How much time does it take from end to end? How much time does it take between two events that happen in a process? And stuff like that. And these are KPIs. It's not letting me go. So these are KPIs that are very, very important. You could also notify, God could also notify himself when these KPIs are at risk or violated, so he gets notifications. And what's interesting beyond this is we have something called as a notion of business situations. So we have a native high-performance rule engine built into HANA where we could detect business situations that are happening in real time based on events, based on context. So these are two business situations that we've detected. We're saying volumetric weight for Hong Kong is high today. And you may want to, we're proposing a next best action. We're saying you may want to switch the flight to an Airbus, a bigger plane, right? So he could then choose to accept this. The system's also detecting that there is a KPI, which is the shipment loading, which is going slow. And you may want to assign a T4 squad to loading. A T4 squad is a four people squad, which is typically getting assigned to gates to speed up the process of loading. So these are business situations that you could really accept. We also build this flight control. So you get a flight control because dashboards are sort of thing of the past. People want to see things in their context, the way how it is in reality. So this is a workspace, a component, which actually tells them where these planes are. So you click on a hub. You see what are the different planes that are going to land. So these are events that are coming from the air traffic controller into the system where we're seeing these planes. There are three planes that are about to land. I click on a plane, I find out whether it's on time and how many shipments it's bringing in. So as a hub operations manager, Gert could really prepare himself on what's coming up next. And the next part that we're building into this is bringing in weather patterns in. Right? So when you bring in weather patterns into this from a third-party source, you're sort of mixing events with weather patterns, and you could really see what planes could get delayed. Right? So this is about bringing events and third-party data and contextualizing it for someone like Gert. Now let me go back and show you how we build something like this. This is not really custom developed from scratch. So I want you to meet Frank Kierforth. He's actually a colleague who sits in the next building. And Frank is a logistics expert. He uses, he wants to always build iterative workspaces for line of business users. So he uses something called as a business scenario editor. So this is design time. This is actually part of the HANA development. And he uses something like this. So what does he do? He goes in and creates what we call as a business scenario. So this is a native inbuilt HANA artifact. The whole system is running inside HANA. It's a very small footprint system running inside HANA, no application servers whatsoever. It's all running inside HANA. So inside HANA, I would be able to create something called as a business scenario. And what's a business scenario? Business scenario is an entity which allows Frank to assemble the end-to-end process. Because end-to-end process can happen across multiple systems. It could happen in SAP systems, non-SAP systems. Parts of the process could just be streaming events that are coming in from, you know, shop flow systems or click streams. So the key thing is to assemble this end-to-end process. And the approach that we took is not a modeling approach. You don't have to model this end-to-end process upfront. But we took an approach of discovering the end-to-end process from already running, executing systems. So let me give you a quick example. So I have a business scenario created here called bpmNEXT. And I'm going in and going into something called as a search console. And I'm connecting into systems which support a concept that we built called process facade. I'm going to talk about what process facade is. Process facade, in short, is a layer that we put across process systems so that we could abstract these systems and have common APIs, REST-based APIs, to get process logs, process definitions, so on and so forth. So what I'm doing is I have these SAP systems. There could also be non-SAP systems connected via gateway systems which support this process facade. And I'm connecting into one of these systems. So SAP systems typically, if you look at our ERP, CRM, SRM systems, they have notion of inbuilt processes. Order to cash process, hiring process, procurement process, financial process are all inbuilt. They're written in code, right? So we're sort of getting events from there and recreating these processes. So we could also connect to a BPM system, which is allowing you to orchestrate a process. You could connect into a PI system, which allows you to build a straight-through process. Or you could get message flows from PI, which is actually connecting two systems. You could also connect to third-party systems if they implement the notion of process facade. There are also other multiple ways to connect to third-party systems. I'm going to talk about it. So I go here. So I want to search for something called process observation, which is actually observing all the suite processes that we have, right? All the suite processes, we put in a layer which observes these transactions. SAP systems run transactions. They don't run processes. And transactions are run in a sequence. So what we are doing is we put an observation layer where we're writing all of this into a common business process analytics format, a BPAF format. And I was talking to Keith about this in the morning. So we use BPAF to standardize on process execution events. And we use the format to really mine and get the process out. So let me take a procure to process, pay process. In this case, I'm just dragging in. And this is going back into a SAP Business Suite system. It's reading all the logs. And it's sort of creating a BPMN model out of this executed logs, right? So it's taking a while because it's connecting to a system. There's another thing which I pulled out, which is an order to cash. And what we have here is each of these steps here have events. So this is process monitoring extensions that we have built in. So each and every step that you have has events. It's got a context of all the different sales order IDs, customer name, ship to party, and things like that. We bring in context, we bring in process events, we bring in the process definition from backend systems. I could connect to any system that supports process facade. All of our systems support it. I could also bring in modeled workflows. So workflows are modeled in a suite system. So I could go in and bring in a modeled workflow. There are several workflows out there, and I could simply drag and drop the modeled workflow. And that's also based on a BPAF format, a common format for process logs. So we were able to reconstruct these processes and visualize them. Once you have this process, what you establish is correlation. So let me go back to something that I'd already created. If you do not have such process, you could also define an observed process on top. So we have a process, BPM N2 process modeler here, where you could define your process, you could define the steps, you could define all the events that you want, so on and so forth. The reason why we did this is because the example I showed you, the customer doesn't have any SAP system in that process. They have SAP to do HR, they have SAP to do financials, but for their core big process, they do not have any SAP system, sadly. So you could also do an observed process like this. You have a BPM N2 modeler where we are modeling an observed process and we're defining the events that are needed. And all these events can be consumed via BPAP format. So we have different tools like data services, PI, so on and so forth, which allows us to get events from multiple sources, convert it into BPAP format, and move it into HANA, where we use that, right? And once I set this up, we could also define measures, we could define cycle times. So once I assembled the end-to-end process, I could define measures, I could define indicators, you know, KPIs, I could define actions that I want, and so on and so forth. I could define attributes, so I'm mixing process logs with context, as Frank. And once I define all of this, I don't want to write any code. I just click on a button here, and we generate all the necessary HANA artifacts that are needed. So we generate, you know, MDX compliant calculation views. We generate REST services. We generate roles, privileges, and everything that's needed to run the scenario. And all of this are inside HANA. We use HANA as a native runtime to execute all of this. And we could also, for example, have decision tables. So here I have a decision table which is built into HANA. And it has some data foundation, and I've defined a decision table which says, based on destination, category, volume, determine the flight number, determine the flight type, and determine the dock number, right? So when things change, a business user simply has to change this in Excel sheet. So we are building business user UIs, but the business user simply has to change it in Excel sheets, and it just gets uploaded into HANA, and then it starts using this for all the calculations and rerouting. So these are rules, operational rules, very, very high volume rules, high volume decisioning that's built in into the platform. So because I'm generating all of this, I could use it for future analytics purposes, right? So we are building a process data mart where we are collecting all this historical data. It could be used in this workspace that I showed you for operational intelligence, but the same data that we collect for operational intelligence without any massaging, without any processing, no extraction transformation loading, none whatsoever in analytics tools. Because we are building a semantic process data mart inside HANA for each scenarios. So, you know, I have something like this. I could build, for example, a story which says what's the operational load on a system. You see Cincinnati and Hong Kong showing up here. This can be used to find process bottlenecks in the future, use analytics. In an operational review meeting, you could really use this to find out where are your process bottlenecks without doing any additional extra work. I just wanted to talk to you about this notion of process facade. We're able to do this because we've standardized across all these platforms based on a notion of process facade. So we're talking about BPMN, modeling standardization, and things like that. It's really important that we standardize across modeling tools, but what we don't have as a consensus in our entire group is on process logs. And this is extremely critical when you want to do a process visibility or operational intelligence system like the one I showed you, right? Because there are multiple systems where the process goes across. End-to-end process always go across multiple systems, on-premise, on-demand, inbuilt systems, legacy systems, and stuff like that, and there is no way to harmonize on process logs. What we did as a first step is to build a notion of process facade based on existing open standards. So what the process facade allows you to do is get process definitions. It has process definition APIs. So when I actually query different platforms from the back end, we use the notion of the process facade. Process facade has been implemented on all those SAP platforms. So the process definition APIs give me BPMN model with extensions. So what I show you here, this whole business scenario is nothing but BPMN with extensions. So this is simply a BPMN model. We got extensions for monitoring. We got extensions for process performance management, like indicators, KPIs, and everything built into BPMN. And we also got the high-level face view built into BPMN. Because face view is the one that the end users understand. This is where the face view really comes. The face view that you saw, this is a big process model that business users don't understand. And in our user research, we figured out linear models are easy for business users to understand, and that's why we had the face view. So I click on each of these faces. These are some things that I've drawn here. I could configure this face view based on the events. I can determine what's the start of the face, what's the end of the face, and stuff like that. So all this is built in into BPMN extensions. We also have process log APIs, and we standardize on BPAF format, not on XES, but BPAF, because we found that it's quite advantageous to use BPAF to build end-to-end process logs. So when we get events from underlying systems, our system correlates and creates this end-to-end process log, again, in BPAF format. Then we also have process control APIs. Not all our platforms have implemented them completely. The process control APIs allow you to start a new process, stop a process, and so on and so forth. One last picture I wanted to show you. So what I showed you is operational process intelligence. And this picture actually shows you how it fits in with our entire intelligent business operations portfolio. Right, our entire intelligent business operations portfolio is running on HANA, and it starts with using Power Designer for doing enterprise architecture, data modeling, process modeling, collaborative modeling, and stuff like that with Power Designer. Then we have process orchestration, which has PI, BPM, BRM running on HANA again, and we've done a lot of we provided a lot of accelerators and stuff like that. Making it run better on HANA, and also improving process analytics, native process analytics. And then we have operational process intelligence, which also runs on the same HANA box. In addition, we have multiple ways to bring in third-party data, and we have Sybase ESP integrated into it to bring in streaming data from click streams, from shop floors and stuff like that, streaming data. And Sybase ESP would then bring the data again in BPAF format. So that's how we are able to bring all of these things together. So this is a tightly engineered offering. So it's not just thrown into the bag. It's tightly engineered to work together, standardizes on open standards, BPMN, and BPAF, and stuff like that. And that's all I had to present. So thank you so much for your attention, and I'm happy to take questions.